Adaram ye say, whenever I leave the house, and on whatever thing my eyes fall, صبر. الله تعالى سير والله يحب الصابرين. الله تعالى أسلف فجعل فينا
school governing body of South Coast مدرسة
أبصارها خاتمة
وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for availing yourselves to be here this evening with Radio 786 and our special guests. Tonight, as you know, is part of Radio 786's 20th year celebrations. This afternoon we kick off the event with a program at UCT, and the topic there that Professor Saeed Dana had dealt with was colonial Zionism and the Palestinian Nakba. This evening the topic is going to be why ISIS. I'm not going to say much about that. I'll leave you in the capable hands of Professor Dana, and I'll introduce him now. But also, as part of Radio 786's 20th year celebrations, we, as you may know, have a full program tomorrow at Kirsten Bosch. Thank you very much. And the theme is bolstering the African voice. I've actually lost my train of thought, but bolstering the African voice. The idea behind it, obviously, is not just to bolster the African voice, but also to provide a platform to encourage people of the South, people that are marginalized, disadvantaged communities from all over the world, to tell their own stories and to challenge the mainstream and the dominant discourse and narrative. And there are still some tickets available for tomorrow, inshallah. If any of you are interested to come, please let us know. You can contact the radio directly. Of course, we will finish off the function or the celebrations on Friday with the gala dinner, which I'm sure most of you will attend, inshallah. Okay, so without much further ado, I'd like to introduce Professor Saeed Dana, and I'm going to read a summary of a summary of a summary. Just very briefly, Professor Saeed Dana is the Dean at the College of Social Sciences and Professional Studies, University of Wisconsin, Parkside, USA. Professor Dana is a member of the Board of Directors and the Executive Committee of the Trans-Arab Research Institute in Boston. He is also the Policy Advisor to Al-Shabaka, the Palestinian Policy Network. Professor Dana has taught sociology, peoples and cultures of the Middle East, political and economic systems, race and ethnic relations, and class, status and culture. He has contributed to various global media discussions, including, of course, yours truly, Radio 786, on the current affairs programs, and on several issues relating to the Middle East, looking at the conflict in Syria, the uprising of the Arab world, and the occupation of Palestine. He has also written extensively on the conflicts in the Middle East, most recently discussing ISIS. Thus came ISIS, the Eurocentric World Order, and the War on Terror. I could go on and on and on and on. I've had the privilege and the honor of spending the last day and a bit with him, and all I can tell you, aside from the fact that he's a Palestinian living for over 20 years in the United States of America, he's an absolutely lovely guy. Professor Saeed Dana, I welcome you. And I
Assalamu alaikum. I would actually, thank you for this amazing introduction. Speaking of today's lecture, we had the chance to talk to the students today about the Palestinian question. And one of the things that I mentioned is that part of what I do is try to tell the story of my people and the sufferings they have under the colonial Zionism in Palestine. And that's why I will end in the last 5 or 10 minutes with interconnecting the rise of ISIS with the question of Palestine. This is what I will do tonight. There are two questions that people usually ask when it comes to ISIS. The question that is consuming actually most scholars, and this is part of my scholarly work and research actually, is what is ISIS? And that's a very important question actually. They try to understand the organization, membership, the ideology, the hierarchy, and the activities of the organization. And I think that's an important question, but I don't think it is the most important question. I think the most important question that we should be asked, and I think I was the first to propose that question, and I'm trying to answer that, and I don't claim that I have the answer for this, but I have an account on that. Why is ISIS? Why do we have this phenomenon in the 21st century? And what I will do tonight is I will ask two questions first. And in trying to answer these two questions, I will try to construct an account about why we have the rise of ISIS. And if we have time, we could go into what is ISIS. I think it's important, as I said, but I don't think it is the most important. Because the question, what is ISIS, is so have so many answers that would blame Islam and blame the Muslims for a phenomenon. I think Islam and the Muslims have nothing to do with it. The answer lies somewhere else. So I will begin with the first question. I don't have control over the slides. So the first question actually. I will make the connection. It puts out that it has nothing to do with ISIS, actually. And that is, why couldn't the 19th century success of liberalism in Europe, essentially that can be summed up in two major achievements, liberal democracy, or the political suffrage, extension of the suffrage to the rest of the population, and the formation of the welfare state. Why couldn't these two reforms be replicated at a world scale in the 20th century? Now, interestingly enough, we always hear the question, is Islam compatible with democracy? We always hear in scholarship about Arab exceptionalism, that Arabs and Muslims cannot rule themselves, they cannot live like the West. And the question, is Islam and democracy compatible, contains within it an answer, actually, that blames Islam and blames the Muslims. Otherwise, we never hear that question posed for any other place. Although, not only Muslim societies are not democratic. Many societies are not democratic. That's the first thing. Second thing, we have been witnessing a change on the meaning of what liberal democracy is. And I will address this issue, because at one point, democracy in the US was associated with slavery. So you could have democracy, but you can have slavery. For 200 years later, you could have democracy, but you could have racism. Now you have democracy and racism, democracy and sexism, democracy and rendition, democracy and torture, democracy and colonial occupation of other countries. So that didn't happen suddenly. Democracy underwent significant change, and I would address that question, that there is something fundamentally problematic about the concept of liberal democracy that must be addressed. I know it sounds crazy to say that on Western media, for example, but with the Arab uprisings, we actually started seeing that liberal democracy as a term began to be used as part of the tools of counter-revolution to mask and hide and overcome the rights, the earlier demands of the people, like socioeconomic demands particularly. But let me go to the question, why couldn't the Muslim people, the Arab people, and the rest of the people, the African people, the Asian people, and Latin American people, replicate these reforms that took place in Europe in the 19th century? A famous American scholar, economist, Emmanuel Wallerstein, says the answer is very simple. There was no third world for the third world. And that is an interesting answer, because it says basically that Europe did not develop and achieve these reforms independently. Somebody else was paying for these reforms in Europe. Take, for example, the American budget. There is an annual deficit of about $1 trillion a year. Americans never ask, where does this $1 trillion come from every year? The government has to provide about $3 to $5 billion every day for the Americans to be able to live the way they do. Somebody else finances this way of life. So Europe did not develop independently, did not achieve these reforms independently. Europe had to colonize the rest of the world and exploit the rest of the world to be able to finance and pay for it. The third world lacks that. Not only that the third world doesn't have another third world, but even the third world is denied controlling its own resources to be able to finance such reforms. That's the first question, and I'll make the connection with ISIS in a minute. Second question, moving from the actual structure. Moving from the actual structure of the world order, so this question says basically there is a fundamental problem with the world order. It's a Eurocentric order that was founded in 1450. Structure built from 1450 to get this result. Democracy somewhere, be paid off for, but from somewhere else. So in order for Europe to be democratic, have a welfare state, the rest of the world must be the way it is. Because Europe did not develop and achieve these reforms independently. So from the very beginning, I want to say that we have a problem with the world order. It's a Eurocentric world order structured to benefit Europe and pay for the life in Europe. That's the actual world order. That's the actual world order, the structure. Now, we move from the structure to the ideology, because they cannot simply say that we Europeans are better than you and we're going to take your resources and finance our way of life. They have to justify that, and this is the role of ideology. And the ideology that supported this comes from the most celebrated European ideas, actually, from the Enlightenment. And the modern, the project for formation of modern society. And that leads me to my second question. All the ideas about democracy, freedom, come from the Enlightenment, really. And this formation of modernity and modern society. And my second question is, why couldn't these ideas, these great ideas of Europe, the ideas of the Enlightenment and social science from the 17th century on, why couldn't they prevent Europe from, first, colonizing the rest of the world, and actually at some point enslaving two-thirds of the world population? Why couldn't these great ideas prevent Europe from doing these terrible things to the rest of the world? Actually, more skeptical people, and I'm one of them, would ask a totally different question, or a relatively different question. Did these great ideas of Europe actually contribute to enslaving the rest of the world and colonizing the rest of the world? In the sense that they are Eurocentric ideas as well. So when they say freedom and democracy, they mean that for the Europeans, not for the rest of the world. Okay, so both questions say essentially that we have an issue with the world order at the structural level, how it is ordered, the hierarchy. Europe is at the center and everything is constructed to serve the Europeans. That's why we call it Eurocentric World Order. And the ideas that dominate the world, even in the Third World, in the South, most intellectuals do not question, but actually adopt the Eurocentric ideas or the European ideas. And they don't make this connection that these ideas came to justify an existing world order that we think of as a Eurocentric world order. Can we move to the next? So, these ideas are not really new. These questions are not really new. People in the South, in the Third World, have been thinking about them for a very long time. The idea began actually sometimes in the 1920s, when two students from Africa met in Paris in the university, Aimé Césaire, a poet, and Léopold Senghor, who became the president of Senegal later. And they were French citizens, they were famous, but they were not treated as French citizens. And Senghor asked Césaire the famous question that became the foundational idea of the Third World Movement, of Third World Nationalism, or Third Worldism, later became the Non-Aligned Movement. Who are we in this white world, he asked. This is a white world. It's our concept today of saying it's a Eurocentric world. So he asked the question, who are we in this white world? And then Césaire's work in both interesting works, one is called Discourse on Negritude and Discourse on Colonialism, try to answer that question. But the question, the answer really, the most interesting answer came from three African ladies who also lived in Paris, called the Nardal sisters. One of them was called Jane. And she proposed an idea that she called an alternative world order. She called it Black internationalism. And Black internationalism doesn't necessarily mean an internationalism, a world order for the blacks. It simply means that this is a Eurocentric world, and it is the cause, the root cause for all the problems that the world, people of the world, third world face. And we need to replace this existing world order or Eurocentric order with an Afro-centered world order. But it is not Afrocentric in the sense that it's a world order dominated by the blacks or the Africans. It's an alternative one. Which means, since the 1930s, people were recognizing that there is something wrong with the existing world order and must be addressed. And it is the root cause for all the social, political, and economic problems that are confronting the people of the third world. Okay. These are the two questions and a short answer for them. Next. How is that connected to ISIS? And why are we talking about that related to ISIS? One more, can we move one more, please? Okay. Because the idea of a caliphate, this is what the Islamic State is, they said we want to establish a caliphate, is just another political form. In other words, some Muslims believe that the answer to the political, social, and economic problems confronting us is actually in an alternative political model. The Western-oriented models don't work. Why? Because they are designed to serve the West, designed to serve Europe, and pay for Europe's projects. Formation of the welfare state and the liberal democracy that exists in Europe. And they are the root cause for our problems. So the answer to the problems confronting us, whether political, social, or economic, is an alternative political model. And therefore, the caliphate is just another political model, whether we agree with it or not. Whether it is going to solve these problems or not, it is just a political model, another political model. In other words, the idea of the caliphate says that Muslims, or at least Muslims who agree with this idea, believe that the solution to their problems is political. Because when you say caliphate, you're talking about a political model. You're not talking about something else. But in the West, and in the media, in the Western media in particular, they're trying to present, or they present, the idea of the caliphate as being a matter of theology. It is not a matter of theology. And Muslims are aware that the caliph in the Islamic history was not a scholar of Islam for the most part. Most caliphs were not scholars of Islam. They were political leaders for the most part. So, but the idea, the word caliphate sounds weird. Actually, if you say Sharia law on Fox News in the US 3 times, people would run away. It's a very scary word. Why? That's one of the reasons why the media plays on this, how strange the idea. Why? One of the greatest historians of our times, Eric Hobsbawm, studied the European Revolution in between 1789 and 1848, this 60 years of European Revolution. And he studied the terms too. He said terms, of course, are not neutral. Language is not neutral. And he gave us this statement that words are witnesses, which often speak louder than documents. Therefore, what he said, that the revolution, the great revolutions of 1789 to 1884 was, the triumph was not a triumph of industry, because there is no such a thing as industry proper. It was a triumph of the capitalist industry. In other words, he was telling us, industry doesn't have to be capitalist, but what triumphed in that period was the capitalist industry as we know it. The values that triumphed in these 60 years were not the values of freedom and equality. It was the values of the middle class. But they were imposed on us as the idea of freedom, but essentially they are the values of the middle class. It wasn't the value, so it wasn't any values, it was or the idea of liberal society, it was the ideas of the middle class. It wasn't the economies and states in a particular geographical region, but it was the triumph of a particular areas in the world and a particular states, essentially North America and Western Europe. That's how the idioms of that era became dominant, became mainstream. Why I'm saying that? I'm saying that because that's what actually normalized the notion of liberal democracy. It's very, actually, it would seem very weird to argue against liberal democracy and say this reflects the values of the middle class and ignores the majority of the population. In other words, that's why these idioms are common and the idea of caliphate sounds weird. In other words, if this did not happen, if the Muslims won at Poitiers, and probably the Europeans would be speaking Arabic by now if that happened, then the idea of liberal democracy, if said now, would sound weird, and the idea of the caliphate would actually sound more normal. But these idioms are very powerful, and repeating them and asserting them has a lot to do with asserting and reasserting this existing world order. The more we use these idioms, the more we're subscribing to this world order and this hierarchy. In other words, reasserting this world, these idioms, work also to negate and reject the narrative of the other. I mean, if the idea of caliphate sounds weird, the idea of Sharia law sounds weird, right? Then what is rejected here is a whole narrative of the other people. Not only their idioms, but their place in the world.
صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما.